Yeah, first off, I want to say thank you to the organizers of this, to inviting us. We're excited to be here. I know, yeah, John and I did come a long way, so it is exciting to be here to learn a little bit more about what the City Camp is and to talk to you about what GIS is and what it can add into technology and how it can help better serve the community. What I first want to do is I'm going to introduce the three panelists. What we wanted to do is just basically have a conversation with you about what GIS is and what it can do beyond just using maps as reference. So I've got three esteemed panelists with me here. I'm just going to introduce them. Next to me is Ann Payne, the GIS administrator from Wake County. And next to her, next to her is Twyla Deese McDermott, who is with Innovation and Technology from the City of Charlotte. And next to her we have Jim Alberque, who is the GIS Program Manager with the City of Raleigh. Okay, so, let's just get rolling. I'm going to ask the panel a question here about just GIS in general. And maps are something that we're all pretty familiar with as visual representations of information that show us the location of things. What I want to pose to our panel is, what does GIS do beyond that? What does it tell us beyond what we can get from just looking at a mere map? What can we add to our maps from a GIS perspective? So I'm just going to pass the microphone along the way.
Okay. So GIS is more than a pin map. It has tools, multi-dimensional tools for analysis, for modeling, for visualizing the real world and predicting what's likely to occur. So I'll just keep it short and say more than a pin map.
As well as my supervisory job, I'm a manager at Java House, so a database administrator. So I'm going to come from the data side and say that GIS data are not scary, they're not different. They just have a spatial component. We just add an extra field out there. But that field gives us so much information about where it adds the power of place to data. And all of us do understand what maps are, but we're still exploring how we can use that spatial component to enrich the information that we have.
What they said. So in my mind, location is an integration platform. So in the city, right, we have a kind of wide breadth of things and operations that we're responsible for taking care of around the city. And oftentimes it's difficult for us to kind of traverse these operations. And, you know, you hear about silos in cities and, you know, Raleigh is not unique. We kind of have some silos. And we can use location as an integration platform. So we can start to look across business systems and across operations using location along with all of those buzzwords. So when you talk about business intelligence and big data, right, we can start to use location as a way to start to do those sorts of things and add some kind of intelligence and thoughtfulness to that stuff.
So I have something else to say.
And of course you do.
At the City of Charlotte, we could not run our city without this technology. It's used for every operational aspect, from managing our water and wastewater plants to dispatching fire trucks the most quickest way, to picking up your garbage, to predicting where crime is going to occur, to planning our city in our planning department. And when I say that we could not operate our city without this technology, that's not my quote. That came from an executive in our city. We just couldn't do it with the level of resources that we have.
And if you don't believe that, you should hear our phones when it goes down.
Okay, thank you. One of the things that I've been working on over the past year or so, and one of the themes that is recurring within our community at Esri is this idea of resilient cities and smart cities. What I wanted to ask the three of you is to contribute to that conversation. What can GIS contribute to preparing communities and cities better for things that all cities do, whether it be social problems, like some of the things we heard about last night, like hunger, or things like public transportation issues, affordable housing, to natural disasters that all communities face their unique forms of natural disasters. How does GIS help communities prepare for and respond to those disasters, become more resilient to these things?
Just a couple of things, a couple of examples from Wake County. We do support and man in our emergency operations center during disasters at Wake County. We have a nuclear power plant here. Those of you that live here know that, and there's a 10-mile radius for that. We have to know who lives there, who the vulnerable populations are in that area, and prepare for any kinds of evacuations. We also use GIS extensively at Wake County to site our facilities and our services. We have limited resources always in government. We want to make sure that we're providing human services, emergency services, where the population is, and where the vulnerable populations are.
So I'm going to go down the smart city track. I just completed a charter for the Charlotte Smart City Cabinet. And I was asked to write it because of my knowledge and the breadth and depth of the use of GIS and how it can help propel us to be the smartest city on the planet. Did you hear that?
I did.
I think that was a challenge.
So within this charter, there are certain deliverables. And I took liberties since I wrote the charter. And those deliverables are deeply rooted and based on GIS technology. One of those items is deliberate partnerships with the vendor community. And we're fortunate enough to have Esri Charlotte in our backyard and are having a 3D model of the entire Charlotte-Mecklenburg area built out this summer. That 3D model will be the basis of the next generation of spatial analytics and location analytics and business intelligence in our city. We'll be using it to communicate to the public about planned development. We'll be using it for line of sight analysis and a multitude of visualizations that help us communicate with our citizens and help them to understand the impact of development.
Again, like I said. I think that we can take a kind of a tactical as well as kind of a strategic kind of approach to smarter cities and using GIS as a kind of tool set in smarter cities. Every day we are instrumenting our city more and more. We're starting to push capabilities into people's phones and instrumenting our vehicles and our streetlights and our parking meters, and those are all based on location. I don't know what the percentage is, but 90x% of data that flows around a city is location based. And as we instrument these things at a very tactical level, we can start to gain some insight and some intelligence and help the people make smart tactical decisions. At an executive level, it would be nice to do a lot of this business analytics and intelligence to kind of bubble this stuff up to what is the heartbeat of the city right now? What does our parking look like right now? What does our traffic look like? How are we doing picking up the trash today? Those sorts of things. And I think, again, I'm a GIS guy, so I think that GIS is the tool for everything. But you know, in a lot of cases, it is a tool that can help to kind of solve some of these problems and inform decisions and deliver better services and all those sorts of things. At a kind of a personal level, right, I have a real interest in figuring out how do we apply this stuff at a very tactical level to, you know, deliver better services. How do we pick up trash more efficiently? I think Twyla talked about routing fire trucks in Charlotte. That sort of stuff is a home run for GIS, right? That's home run technology. It's not that, you know, it's not a humongous lift from a technology perspective. And it's just a matter of educating kind of the business and the community and making sure, you know, building partnerships, et cetera. And, you know, speaking of partnerships, events like this can help to start to surface some of these opportunities. So I'm excited about that.
I just want to say, if anyone in the audience has any comments, concerns, suggestions, questions they want to throw at us, please don't hesitate to do so. Another thing what we're hearing a lot here at events like this is this idea of open data and developers and technologists using open data to build applications. What I want to pose to the panel here is what concerns are there, or what can we put in place to ensure that people who are using open data know that it's accurate and that we're getting information that is reliable and that things that are being built are coming from reliable sources? What kind of safeguards are in place about data accuracy?
Jim, you
want to
go first?
Sure.
We haven't let you go first.
Thank you.
But then we said what you said.
So first off, I would never measure your bungee cord by the data that we're kind of releasing. You know, we struggle with this. I think that there's a, you know, we're trying to be as agile as possible in releasing data, making data available. At the same time, we know that we need to be thoughtful about the accuracy, the making sure that it's robust and available 24/7, that it's updated on a regular basis. And, you know, Adam Martin, who leads the Open Raleigh kind of program, we talk all the time about what is the right kind of cadence for this stuff. Between the time that we get some business system around data and the time that we can release it, getting into market, and what's the driver for that stuff? And in fact, we recently went through an exercise around a specific thing where we applied GIS to a new kind of problem, and we started gathering data, and there was some interest from the public around this data. And we were a little uncomfortable that we didn't have our internal business process kind of wrapped up, and that people would, you know, potentially public folks would start making decisions based on this data. And so we needed to kind of go back to the business and make sure that we had our business process kind of wrapped up and that we had good kind of maintenance on the data. And I think that we have to apply these kind of conversations to basically every data set. There are some data sets that are just no-brainers, parcels and just hard assets that just don't change very frequently that we do release, and we have very, very high confidence. It's more of the operational data, the more real-time data that we think can add a ton of value, but we just want to be thoughtful and make sure that there's some sustainability around that data.
At the City of Charlotte, we do not have a data quality program, but we do have an open data program. We probably need a data quality program. We believe that open data is going to drive higher data quality once it starts being released and is released. Our most fundamental unit of location is address. I mean, all of the city services are delivered at an address. And this is one data domain where we have made a significant investment because we want to get services delivered where they need to be delivered and where those qualifying services should be occurring. So to that end, for addresses, we've invested in a master data management approach. So this is a discipline for mastering data and ensuring quality. I think there's this merging or intersecting of IT practices that's occurring. My good friend Ann Payne here sent me a cartoon the day before yesterday, and we had hoped to post it up here. But we're hearing a lot today about big data, data analytics, and open data. But in fact, we've been doing this for 30 years already in GIS.
At least Twyla and I have.
We have. We probably won't be doing it another 30 more. But so I think there's this intersect and converging of IT disciplines that's occurring that's driving greater value in data.
Okay, I'd like to address this on a more practical level for you guys. And let me preface it by saying that I am here as a data provider. I'm here to listen to you about what, as data consumers, you want from government and make sure that we're providing in the best way. But our open data portal, which we did just launch, it's been in beta for a while. It took us a while, and one of the reasons is that we had some guiding principles, and if I miss any, Bill, let me know. We wanted to make sure that our data were curated, that they were accurate, timely. We've been very careful to document them. What am I missing? Anything? I'm going good. Okay. And so that people could rely on the data that they download from us. Be really careful about the data. Anybody can throw open data out on a portal out there, and I'm not talking about anybody in the state, but there are people that aren't all that careful about what they put out. They're just so anxious to have open data that they may have old data sets and they have conflicting data sets. Be very cautious. Read the metadata, check out the data, and also make sure you know what the fields mean before you use them. Trust me, this is important advice. And so also look for branding. If you go to our open data site, you'll see Wake County Government, and that's how you can know that it's branded and it's official and it's coming from us. You may find parcels for Wake County published 40 times out there in different places, but if you want to go to get the source. One more thing, and I'm sorry, I'm taking too long. You guys love GeoJSON. Let me just put in a plug for live map services. Please, we have those available. You want data that's accurate, you don't have to store it anywhere on your own system. It's always available, it's always current. Please explore using map services as opposed to downloading data. Thank you. That was my point.
Well, I think that's a good segue for another question about data. How do you as local government and as data curators, what do you do to prepare data before you release it as open data? What are things that you can, I think one of the things, I go out and look at open data and I look at some of those column headers and the first thing that comes to mind is, what the hell is that? And I don't know how to translate that into, how does this have any impact on my daily life or the daily life of the community? What do these column headers mean? What do you do to prepare data before you release it?
In our case, I think our internal users are our best quality control. These data are not just for you. They drive how your home is assessed, how your taxes are paid, how your emergency services are provided, and trust me, those people check it out. In terms of what these fields mean, anybody that's got a good conscience and a good open data program is preparing thorough and complete and good metadata, and look for good metadata when you're looking at any kind of open data.
At the City of Charlotte, we have metadata standards, so metadata is required for all data.
Yes.
And that is being integrated into our open data portal, not quite as seamlessly as we'd like it to right now, but I understand that our vendor's working on that.
Yeah, the vendor could help out with that a little bit.
Point taken.
One more thing that we're doing is developing, and we're in the process of developing this, it's a standard practice for open data. And we already have an open data policy that the city manager signed. The practice is the next level down that really documents institutional knowledge at a higher level of how we manage this open data portal. And attached to that standard practice are standards. Metadata standard is one of them. It's already being conformed to include all data. As it stands today, it's just GIS data, but also procedures and other technical artifacts that document this for the city, so that the next person that comes in doesn't have to recreate the program. So we're really institutionalizing it. So I think there's a question.
Yes, I hope you can hear me. I'm an analyst with a consulting firm. One thing that would help me is not just having the data open, but for all the cities to have similar data standards. Like in terms of, you're talking about the field names and what they mean. When every city has a different standard of how they use their field names, I have to rewrite my software to work with every different city. Is there any effort? So my question is, are you talking to each other about what your data looks like and how you could come up with similar formats for it?
In North Carolina, the answer is yes. There is a body called the North Carolina Geographic Information Coordinating Council.
Which I should have thought to plug, that Twyla and I both serve on.
Yeah, and it has representatives from the federal government, state government, local government, industry, and utilities.
Why don't you talk
about the standards that exist now?
Yeah, we do have standards for a number of our data sets in North Carolina. Everybody's not necessarily following them yet. But we've got some statewide efforts that are going to encourage people, particularly in the area of street center lines and parcels, to adopt some standards. And it may not be every field that we have, but the common fields that most people use. The GICC is all about standards. We have a standards committee. We have standards for orthotography. You will see equal quality and that kind of thing statewide. For aerial photography, which is what orthophotography is. Yes.
Does the standard include some currency timestamps or a window of concurrency of how recent the data had been updated or how often it is updated, and some metric also about the assumed quality? Is it audited? Is it coming from a known source, reliable source, internal source, that kind of thing? So the two different metrics, one would be currency, the other being quality.
Absolutely. His question is, do the standards include anything to assure two parts, currency and quality, which are really important in spatial data? Is that a good summary? And the answer is that's in the metadata standard. We also have a metadata standard, and it ensures, Twyla talked to metadata a minute ago, you will hear GIS people talk about metadata all the time. It's very important to us.
It is in metadata.
And it is in the metadata, yes.
But you want to say anything?
John, you've got about 5 minutes. 5 minutes.
All right.
Another question?
Are you out of time?
No.
No, we got
5 minutes.
Oh, it was just a comment. So I get really excited when I hear that you're going together and integrating with metadata and integrating with standards. I'm from Ohio, so back when the Ohio Libraries decided to get together and standardize on their catalogs and their books, it started as a statewide effort and then it became a worldwide effort. So I see a lot of similarities, and I'm really glad that North Carolina is moving towards having those consistencies and standards and all that. So it's great.
I am from Ohio also. She made a comment about me and said that North Carolina is moving to the standards, and is going to comment on it.
OCLC used to be Ohio Library or something, now it's the online
standard. Okay, two quick things. Some of the standards that we have adopted as North Carolina standards are actually federal standards as well. The federal
Federal Geographic.
They, Federal Geographic Data Committee.
Yeah.
It has a number of standards. We have adopted many of those at the North Carolina level as state standards. Also want to just put in a shameless plug for something called NC1 Map. If you want to look for state level data, we do have a state level clearinghouse of data. It's not quite an open data portal yet, but will be soon. And if you'll just go to, if you'll just Google NC1 Map, as in O-E-N-E map, you can find quite a few state level data sets as well. Sorry.
I guess one other topic to bring up that, just to get your thoughts on, what about real-time GIS or real-time data? What kind of things are you incorporating at the local level of those?
So we do have operational data that's real-time data or near real-time data published through our open data portal. And if you heard my lightning talk last night, I talked about CityGram and how applications can consume that data and send out alerts based on database qualifiers like timestamps. Real-time data is going to be more important in the city of Charlotte. I mentioned the smart city charter that we're implementing. For our city, to be a smart city means that we really are capitalizing and investing for the public sector in the Internet of Things. And the Internet of Things really is, everything is connected to the Internet through a device. When we connect our data, we really are providing the power, the juice, the gas for those devices that have those applications that are informing citizens, informing users on their area of interest.
So this is an area that I think that personally I have a lot of passion for, and we're making a lot of strides in Raleigh. Earlier I talked about instrumenting our city. We're doing that now. Our parking meters, AVL, a lot of our vehicles have AVL, our big belly trash cans, our buses, etc. Trying to use that data in a kind of useful way is the challenge that we have. So, for instance, internally we're trying to put together a real-time analytics dashboard that will tell you, of all the parking spaces that are in the city, how many are currently taken, right? That's interesting on an executive level. What's the average bus speed across our entire network? How many public utility vehicles are out right now? How many permits did we get, operationally? How many permits did we get today? How many of those were deck permits? How many of those were, refits? Or, those sorts of things are really interesting. Not only that, but at an executive level, but you can start to use this at a tactical level. So, can you use this to help, right? We're already doing this with our greenways and Translope to help people figure out, should I go to the bus right now? Is the bus on time? When is the bus running late? That's all real-time data. And the proliferation of wearables and instrumenting our cities and the smart city kind of movement will only kind of make that more and kind of widen where that data is coming from. We have a question in the back. Go ahead.
I just want to raise the concern that at least some segments of the population will be suspicious about government and how much other monitoring is going on. I'm wondering if you've encountered that and how you're thinking about that.
We are thinking about that a lot. So the question was around governments thinking about the access to data and personal information and just around the concern around data access and kind of monitoring people, correct?
Well, yes, in particular when someone says, well, you say you have a monitor on that parking spot, what the heck does that mean? You may mean one thing, but especially if as rumors fly around the internet, it could mean something very different to the large stakeholder of your community before you know about it.
Yes, so we are definitely concerned about this, and I think that's a lens that we, every time we do kind of anything or release data or release an application, we're trying to use the lens of what is the perception of the public? Are there concerns? We do things in Raleigh like focus groups and kind of vet it through the business as well as vet it through some constituencies outside of the city, and we are very thoughtful about that. And right, again, there is always going to be a balance between trying to be agile and innovative and kind of taking time to do all of the vetting that needs to be vetted.
Yeah, if only the public were as concerned as a consumer what's being done with their data as they were with government. But I think we as people, as humans, we need to be concerned about our digital rights. I agree with you. What our city is doing is using a data advisory committee to adjudicate data before it's published. And this would be data that, you know, has some, raises an eyebrow about whether or not it's appropriate. And there are four dimensions, or four categories that data is run through, and that is information security, is it restricted data? HR, are there any human resource concerns that we should have? Homeland security, does releasing this data put our city at risk? And then just a legal overview. So we do look at the data that we put out, and Charlotte is a very conservative city, and we've got a lot of work to do to overcome unnecessary concerns to release data to the public.
John, why don't you take 1 minute to kind of sum things up and tell us a little bit about, I mean, honestly, Esri,
Well, I think to sum things up, what I would say is to remember everything happens somewhere. So geospatial is an important component to data and to information. I think at Esri, what we really believe is GIS is a tool, but it's also an approach to problem solving and a way about thinking about problems and providing answers. And so we have a bunch of ways that you as technologists can interact with data of all forms using GIS as a way to think about problems and as a tool to solve those problems. So that's how I would sum it. I want to thank the panel for taking my questions, and thank you to the audience for listening, and thank you again, CityCamp, for offering this opportunity to be up here.